calculate and build on your wins. You remember the story of the 10 lepers who were healed and only one turned back to thank Jesus? And he was a Samaritan. Now remember, Samaritan women were considered to have less value than a man's donkey. And yet Jesus looked at him and out of the 10, he said, where are the others? You are made whole. So when he made clean the other lepers, he healed them in the story. Only the one who turned back to give thanks was made whole. You know the story. I think gratitude beneficially and holistically gives us an advantageous quality in our lives so that we can have the something plus, the charisma. We can have a wholeness about us. People can sense we're not just healed, but we're whole. People can sense we have that presence, that exousia, that authority. And so what I want to say to you is when you calculate and build on your wins, that gratitude will compound further wins so that you're not just healed, but holistically, beneficially, you're made whole. So here's what's interesting. I have not felt always like coming into the studio lately because my car's been in the shop. I am so thankful that I get to come in and do this. But the fact of the matter is I have to run hills to and from here to make it happen. I've also been rucking with my friend Toby. And so I've done 82 miles in a week and a half up an elevation of 7,100 feet. That's almost a quarter of the way to Everest as far as just elevation goes. So Everest is a little over 29,000 feet. I've done 7,100 feet, 82 miles of running and rucking, climbing and running in the last week and a half. So my legs are on fire. I've trained every day for years, but this is something different for me. And I walk around like I'm FDR, which is to say I don't walk well at all. I mean, that was a little too close to the bone, but FDR has rested in peace for quite a while now. Be that as it may, I stopped. It took maybe 10, 15 minutes to calculate, like, how far have I actually run and how far have I actually climbed? So I looked on my fitness app and I'm like, you know what? I feel a lot better. And that galvanized me into continuing to run. In the same way, I want to tell you, if you will stop to turn back to praise, if you will stop to feel grateful, if you will stop to calculate your wins, you will then build on those wins, which will compound further victories. Now, Socrates talked a lot about the power of disciplining yourself. He said too much liberty leads to an excess of slavery. If you're just like, you know what, I'm free to do anything. It's been said too much freedom is like being thrown out into the middle of the ocean. You might be totally free, but it's not an enjoyable situation. If you're immersed in chaos and you have no structure or order imposed on your life, then by not being disciplined, you're going to become a slave. So it was said Alexander the Great, he gave off the impression that his body was his slave. Now, if you don't make your body your slave, just as he would love to run to catch up to a horse and jump on it, he was very good at disciplining his body. He gave off the impression that his body was his slave. If we'll do that, then we will not become slaves to our appetites. To the belly god is what Paul called it in the book of Philippians. Their god is their belly. We don't want our belly to be our god. Because here's what happens. For instance, if you say, well, I'm free not to work out. Okay, by being free, you're going to end up being a slave to your body when your body gets sick and falls into disrepair. If instead, conversely and contrarily, you go in the diametrically opposed direction and you say, I will make my body my slave, I will beat it into subjection and submission, 1 Corinthians 9, as Paul said, then suddenly, as you're more disciplined, you become more free. You're free to move. You're free to live. You're free to burn, burn, burn like fabulous oil, Roman candles, burst like spiders across the stars, and everyone sees the explosion and goes, ah, the mad ones, as Kerouac talks about. So he says, if you have too much excess of liberty, that actually leads to an excess of slavery. So he was talking about people, especially youths who just don't know what they want to do. They're like all over the place. They're like, okay, one minute I'm going to play in the flute. Then I'm going to dabble in politics. Then I'm going to try to be a businessman. Then I'm going to try to be a warrior. Then I'm going to try my hand at just being a water drinker to get thin. And he's saying, basically, by being everything, they become nothing. And that's true for you. If you aim at nothing, by becoming everything, you're going to become a nobody. If you are aimless, you're going to be nameless. So by disciplining yourself and making your body your slave, then suddenly you actually become the most free person because your body is capable of doing what it needs to do. And when your life is in order and not subsumed by chaos, you have then liberty to do the calling that God has placed on your life. And that's why Socrates warned against having too many callings in his conversation with Glaucon. So by trying to become everything, you become nothing. So like Alexander the Great, make your body your slave. Give off the impression that you're so disciplined that your body's a slave. Like when you see Tom Brady walk around, you get the impression that his body is a slave. He's 45 years old and he's doing really well as an NFL quarterback. He makes his body his slave. Now, Socrates said youth is the time for extraordinary toil. That echoes and is a reverberation of Lamentations 3, which says, it is good for a man to bear the yoke in his youth. Laziness in youth will kill you. When you're young, when you're strong, that is the time for extraordinary toil. That is the time to say, I am going to bear the yoke. That is the time to plow in the field. That is the time to get after it. He said, okay, so when you're 35 years old, you should be tossed back into the den. This was what Socrates believed. You should be tossed back into the den and you should bear office or military service and face various and sundry weathers and go through all manner of temptations. And if you can emerge without flinching, without fainting, and if you can be distinguished in every action and every branch of philosophy you've mastered, every branch of knowledge, then at the age of 50, so that's 15 years after 35, at the age of 50, philosophy should be your chief pursuit. Then you can bear political office. Then you can rule over others. You can rule yourself. You can order the state and maybe even be honored as a demigod. But he said that's going to happen at 50. And he said the reason philosophy has fallen into disrepair, he argued, is because there's all these people philosophizing without having a career. So he talked about how young people just like to mimic the masters. It's a mimetic thing. They argue with one another like puppy dogs, always trying to tear everything they see apart. Not because they actually know what they believe, but because they think they know what they think, but really they just like to die on hills. They just like contention. Those people are not very fun to talk to. I think we've all experienced that. But at the age of 50, then you are able to lift the eye of your soul, Socrates believed, to observe the universal light, which lightens every man, and then become a ruler in the state and bear office as a duty and make philosophy your chief religion. Now, Socrates, his number one first principle, as you may know, is know thyself, okay? Kierkegaard came on the scene and was the first one to question, know if there is a thyself, right? Of course, Descartes, cogito ergo sum, I doubt, therefore I think, therefore I am. But to question not my existence, but existence itself, that was what Kierkegaard did. And he was basically saying, know if there is a quote unquote thyself. But Socrates said, know thyself. That was the first rule of philosophy. Now, to Socrates, the definition of sin was ignorance. And Kierkegaard writes about this in The Sickness and the Death. He believed that ignorance was sin. And that's why in his Allegory of the Cave, which I've been studying in depth lately, he talks about how if prisoners are chained and their necks are chained and they are in a cave and they're just facing the wall of the cave, but there's a fire that's causing flitting shadows to go across the walls and there's people outside and there's events happening outside, but you can't turn around to see the light of the sun or to see what's happening in the real world. All you can see are shadows cast upon the wall. That's something akin to or approaching epistemological nihilism. How do you know that our reality now, if the fire is the sun, if we're the prisoners, if we're everything we're seeing is, this is epistemology, like how do we know it's not just shadows in the dark? How do we know we're not viewing a hologram? How do we know what is reality itself? And so he argued that the most important rule of philosophy is know thyself. And so he said ignorance itself is a sin. And even Peter talks about adding to virtue knowledge, whereas Kierkegaard argued that virtue is not the opposite of sin, but faith is the opposite of sin. And he proffered and offered the idea and ideal of becoming the knight of faith. And by, you know, living the beatific vision, you become a technician by not having too many callings, but focusing on one thing rather than trying to be everything and becoming nothing, aimless and nameless. So Socrates, he argued, know yourself. Sin is ignorance. And Kierkegaard said, everything Socratic we should honor, even if he didn't always agree quite with everything. So ignorance is sin. Now, sin in the Bible is known as periptoma, epithumia, and hamartia. Hamartia is an archery term, means to miss the target. That's why we love sports. It's actually deeper than just trying to put a ball through a hoop or in a net. It's like we love to see masterful excellence of virtuosos hitting a target, right? Periptoma and epithumia also means to slide across a line or to trespass. We all slip up, we do that, right? But to Socrates, I love this definition. Ignorance is sin. So how do you live the good life? Here's how you do it. By accumulating, assimilating, and collating knowledge. Gain knowledge. That's the way to wisdom. That's the way to wisdom. And clearly, the book of Proverbs and Ecclesiastes argues this as well. However, a lot of the things we think are wise are actually equated with stupidity. So Kierkegaard argued that apologetics is stupidity, which makes sense to me because I have never really been a fan of apologetics. I liked Chesterton's The Everlasting Man best, but other than that, mere Christianity has some good ideas, but for me, I'm not a big fan of apologetics. He equated apologetics with stupidity because he said anything that you are trying to defend, you are discrediting it as if it's something so weak that it needs defending. So if something is so weak that you need to defend it, you're discrediting it. Therefore, apologetics is equated with stupidity. We're not people who are trying to defend our positions out of you know, trying to die on hills like these young people who are snapping like puppy dogs, trying to tear apart everything that comes in their path. No, we want to be people who come up with original ideas. I hope that when you listen to me talk, this is my goal, that I'm saying things you really haven't heard before. I don't want you to be like, this sounds like something every pastor says or something. Or no, I believe in the quote yourself, which is funny because that's a quote from somebody else, which is very hypocritical on my end. But I really do believe, like, come up with your own quotes. That's why I love to come up with my own quotes. I want to tell you stuff that's never been heard before. So here's my big idea for today. Listen, build on and calculate. Calculate and build on your wins. By calculating and building on the knowledge of the philosophers who are dead. The great thought leaders of history milk many cows, as it's been said, and churn your own butter. In a way that you're saying, okay, I am going to not just listen to what's trendy, falsify data, fake information, pseudo news, flat earth jargon gibberish. No, I'm going to be somebody who calculates and builds on the philosophies of the dead as they emerge like ghosts from the mist with treasure troves under their arms, wisdom in their mouths, and the keys of sagacity in their fingers. I want to be somebody who listens to the greats. My time is spent reading dead philosophers. That's what I do. Like, I just sit around reading dead philosophers. I want to encourage you to read the greats of old. Isaac Newton, he said, if I've seen further than others, it's because I've stood on the shoulders of giants. When I quote other people, it's because I want to put my own twist on something. So If Isaac Newton hadn't built the Principia, then how would Einstein have come up with his ideas had he not predicated it, for example, on the Lorentz principle? And Newton, just as Plato was the most consummate philosopher, perhaps, along with Socrates, but they're one and the same, so too, Kierkegaard is the one who began to question existence itself and put his own twist on it. So too, if you look at somebody like Newton, who might be the best physicist of all time, and yet Einstein comes and puts his own twist on things. So too, I want to like build layer on what I've learned from the dead in the past, not just what's trendy right now, because science you have to listen to the science of the day. And I'm talking about real science. I'm not talking about pseudoscience. That being said, I want to be somebody, and I want you to be somebody who really goes to the greats. Like, we have the capacities by reading books, and these books are cheap. They're cheaper than like New York Times bestsellers, which are like 7 tips to being your best self, which is fine. Actually, that was not a jab at anybody. I really didn't intend it that way. I'm just saying, like, whatever it is, it's and I was thinking like Your Best Life Now, 7 Tips. I haven't read that book. I'm sure it's great. So if that sounded like a jab at that, it really wasn't. I'm sure that's a really great book. I'm just saying, like, the wise philosophers who are dead Read them. Focus on them. Go back to the greats. Go back to the original thinkers. And as you calculate and build on the knowledge of others that you might see further, like Einstein on Newton, like Kierkegaard on Socrates, so too, if you use and collate and assimilate and accumulate the data and information of those who are dead, then you're not just going to be another person spouting off whatever's trendy right now, and it's probably fake. But instead, you're going to calculate and build on your own wins by calculating and building on the knowledge of others. And then that's going to compound, and you're going to be grateful for this knowledge, and you're going to be able to take it to run to the ends of the earth and accomplish something. Not just having many callings, but one calling. So can I encourage you to calculate and build on your wins? And if you want to have the strength to do that, compound it by calculating and building on the wisdom of those who came before you.